Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I'm Dr. Muhammad Hussain, currently serving as an assistant professor in GIT Institute of Engineering Sciences and Technology, Pakistan. So this lecture is about the hydrology and water management course. We will cover in this chapter the fundamentals of hydrology. So what really fundamentals of hydrology means? That in this lecture, after this lecture, you will be able to describe the hydrological cycle. You will be able to delineate the drainage basin based on a topographic map. And you will be able to calculate the time of concentration. We will like study what exactly is time concentration, how we can calculate it, and we'll do some numericals and what is the importance. So basically, you need to know the basics. You need to know what parameter is. What are its applications and how we can quantify that parameter. So this includes the basics. And then we will find the return period and storm frequency for a given rainfall intensity. And we will study the something, some similar, some stuff regarding the rainfall. And then we will describe the construction of a hydrograph, which is basically a pillar of hydrology, and we will study by using unit hydrograph, and we will do some numericals where we'll like prepare some hydrographs. And then we will study the principle of superposition and the principle of proportionality, which we use in preparing the unit hydrographs. And then finally, in this chapter, we will study about routing of flood wave. So this is basically the content of this lecture. After this lecture, you will be able to understand these topics. So, first thing first. So, first thing is basically the hydrological cycle. So, we know that nature is a great recycler and the water is a prime example. The water that flows in streams comes from the oceans and is returned again in a constant cycle called the hydrological cycle, right? In school, we studied that, okay, water evaporates from the oceans and lakes of the earth, and then this evaporated water vapors forms into the cloud. And then when these clouds, like move through the atmosphere in different global weather patterns, the water vapor condenses and precipitates in the form of rain, snow, or hail. Then the rain lands on the grounds and flows to the stream, and then stream flows to the rivers and eventually into the oceans and lakes. Here, I would like to explain one difference between weather and a climate. Sometimes we misinterpret these two terms. Weather is basically the short-term representation of the of any areas like precipitation or temperature. This is a short-term representation. This is called the weather. Like you cannot say that the weather of this like 50 years of this area is like this. You can only predict the weather for like 1 week or 10 days. But in terms of climate, climate is basically the long-term representation of a particular area. Let's say this, the area, the climate of this area is humid. It means that it is based on like historical data that is maybe somewhere like 50 years or 100 years data. But for weather, it's a short-term representation, like in terms of days or weeks. And the climate is the representation in a long-term representation, like in for decades. So in hydrological cycle, this is like we know that water evaporates and then it forms clouds, and then when the clouds condense, then it precipitates in the form of rain, snow, water, and then this rain lands on the ground and flows through the streams, and then finally these streams moves the into the lakes and oceans. So now, here in this diagram, it will be easy to understand. You can see this is like Here is, let me select the pen. Here is our clouds. Okay, then there will be a precipitation. So this is like the precipitation. The precipitation happens, then some of the flow, then there is some water that will flow on the surface, right? This is called the surface runoff, right? And then there will be some infiltration, and then the surface runoff will move to the open bodies like lakes or rivers, and then there will be some evaporation from water surface, right? And then some of the water will be infiltrated from these open surfaces, and if it moves in the unsaturated zone subsurface to the nearest like river or ocean, then it is called the subsurface flow. Let's say if it goes deep and becomes the part of the groundwater, then it is called the percolation. Like if the infiltration is like the water infiltrates at the surface, and when that infiltration literally moves, then it is called in the unsaturated zone, it is called the subsurface flow. But if that water, infiltrated water, becomes the part of groundwater, like there is a deep vertical infiltration, then this process is called the like percolation, that moves deeply. It's basically the deep percolation. And then everything like the groundwater flow moves towards the lowest points, but the speed of the groundwater, the velocity of groundwater movement is very low, like 1 to 2 meters per day. So here you can also see that evaporation and then transpiration terms. So here is the transpiration. So evaporation is normally the vaporization of water from liquid to gas from the open surfaces, but the transpiration is basically the evaporation that happens from the leaves of the vegetation or any trees. So this is called the transpiration. So when we talk about evapotranspiration, so this is basically the combination of evaporation and transpiration, right? So here is also one phenomena explained here, seawater intrusion. So this is the reason that we need to send fresh water into the ocean, because we don't want that ocean travels towards our freshwater resources are towards our groundwater. That's the reason that in coastal cities like in Karachi in Pakistan, there is no drinking water. The groundwater is like salty because there is a seawater intrusion. Although we are discharging a much larger amount of water into the sea, but due to lack of management, there is a seawater intrusion phenomena, that sea is moving towards the cities and towards groundwater. And it pollutes our groundwater, and that's why there is an issue of drinking water in mainly in coastal cities if there is a lack of management. So hopefully you understand the basics of hydrological cycle. So in the hydrological cycle, in terms of explanation, is the central focus of hydrology. You need to know the overland flow, subsurface flow, and surface runoff. So to understand these things, let me go to the next slides. Here you can see when there is a precipitation, there is some water that will move on the surface. That is called the overland flow or surface runoff. In different books, the different terminologies will be used. Sometimes it's called overland flow, sometimes it is called surface runoff. So you need to understand this thing. That's why I have added the slides from two different books. So the water that will infiltrates and move towards the lowest point. So the lowest points are our rivers or any natural streams, and move towards it in the unsaturated zone, the lateral movement, then this flow is called the subsurface flow. And when it becomes the part of groundwater due to the phenomenon of percolation, then it's also moved towards our streams. So sometimes our groundwater contribute to our streams, and in lowlands, in highlands, the streams contribute to our groundwater, and in lowlands, groundwater sometimes contribute to our streams. So there is always an interaction between filtration from the streams and the groundwater contribution to the stream. So here we, up till now, I believe that you know basically what is overland flow, what is subsurface flow, what is groundwater, what is transpiration, what is evaporation, what is evapotranspiration, and the groundwater, what is the speed of groundwater. So this is the basic thing which I want that at this point you need to know. So then the hydrological cycle, these basic terms, evapotranspiration, then the ones in the red with the base flow and the red runoff, I have explained you in the previous slides by showing you the representation of an image of the hydrological cycle. So next thing, basically, I would like to tell you that is the drainage area. Let's say when we talk about hydrology and you want to do some hydrological analysis, you always talk about the catchment area or drainage area. So the drainage area or catchment or basin or a watershed, this is basically one name, the different names for a one thing. So here, if you want to remember the definition of a catchment area, watershed, or drainage basin, the area that contributes water to a river is called its catchment, right? So how we delineate the catchment? We delineate the catchment based on the topographic contours. We imagine that the rainfall drops, then in which direction it will travel. So normally, the rainfall will travel perpendicular to the, at each point, perpendicular to the contour lines. So, and when we study about the hydrographs, we will study in the next slides, we always calculate the hydrograph at the point of analysis. So this is basically the stream, and then this is the area which contributes to that river if there is a rainfall as a surface flow. So this is called the catchment area of that particular river. And there is the boundary which divides this particular catchment from the other catchment is called the basin divide. And this point, basically this point is the point of analysis where we study all the stuff like the flow gauge or we measure different things like hydrograph. So now, next slide is basically about the time of concentration. Let's say in this particular drain catchment, there's a rainfall. There will be rainfall over the entire area, right? And then, So time of concentration is basically that from the remotest point, the time it takes for the rainfall or water to travel from the remotest point to the point of analysis. This is basically the time of concentration. So now there are different things. Let's say first, when the size of drainage basin has been determined from the delineation of the catchment, the next step in finding the Q is basically the discharge is the time of concentration. So the time of concentration is the measure of time needed for the runoff to flow from the upper end of the watershed to the lower end or point of analysis, right? Upper end means the remotest one. Each watershed has its own unique time of concentration because it depends on the size, shape, slope, and groundwater conditions. To estimate time of concentration, we locate the remotest point in the watershed, but you need to remember that remotest point may not be the farthest point from the point of analysis by distance. For example, let's say if runoff travels slowly due to slope and ground cover conditions, it might require the greatest amount of time, even though not covering the greatest distance. And the runoff, the paths which is taken by the runoff is called the hydraulic paths, right? So you need to remember that the remotest point on ground distance may not be the remotest point that you will analyze for the time of concentration. You need to know that it depends on the size, It depends on the slope ground cover conditions. Let's say if there is a sandy soil, then there will be less surface runoff and more infiltration, right? If there is a if there is like a paved surface, there will be no infiltration, not really no, there will be very minute infiltration and maximum surface runoff. So if the point which is like very near but it's not paved, it will take more time for the runoff to move towards the point of analysis. But if the remotest point, the path is like paved to the point of analysis, then it will not be the it will not serve as the point to calculate the time of concentration. So you need to know from which point it takes maximum time to reach the surface runoff to the point of analysis. So the time for runoff from the remotest point along the hydraulic part to the point of analysis is illustrated in the figure 10-8. I will show you the figure 10-8. This type of flow is identified for each path. We will try to cover one example too, and then you add all these times for overland flow, for shallow concentrated flow, and stream flow. So let's say time of concentration, we understand that is from the remotest point to the point of analysis, the time it takes. So when there is a rainfall, the initial flow is always the usually the overland flow. When the rainfall starts, it is characterized by sheet flow and it moves down the slope. And normally the overland flow flows up to the 100 feet before consolidating into a more concentrated flow. And then shallow concentrated flow, that the flows becomes into small rivulets. And then in stream flow, these all rivulets merge and become a stream or a river, right? So you need to remember that overland flow, the time of concentration is measured by a nomograph. Shallow concentrated flow, you can also determine by nomographs, or we have some graphs. And for stream flow, we can use the Mann equation. So how to study the nomograph? I will explain in the next slide. So this is basically the nomograph. Let's say you have a strip of 100 meter and the average and the land use is average grass, and the slope is like 2%. So what will be the time of concentration? So let's say, so what you need to do is from 100 to, you will come straight to the average grass, which is the land cover, and you will come straight to the pivot line. And then you will go from this point to the slope. Our slope was 2% and you will come straight. Sorry, I couldn't draw the straight line, but you need to go to the straight line, straight. So it will be somewhere 10, 11, and 12. 12 minutes will be the time of concentration. So this is how you study the nomograph. So this is then the shape figure. Here you can see the remotest point. So initially flow type A, is basically, you know the initial flow will be overland flow. So there is overland flow, and in B, it is basically the shallow concentrated flow, and when then shallow concentrated flow will go, will change into the stream flow. For overland flow, nomograph. For shallow concentrated flow, we can use the nomograph or some other graphs. And for stream flow, we'll use the Mann equation. So this is also one graph, average velocities for estimating the travel time for shallow concentrated flow. These kind of graphs we can use, where we can, for average velocity, we can find the, for, you can see if we have watershed slope, and if you know the land use, then we can find the average velocity. And then from this velocity, we can find the time of concentration. We will solve one numerical, then all these things will be get more clear. So here, determine the time of concentration for a drainage basin shown in figure 10-8. This was basically 10-8. This where initially there is a overland flow, then there is a shallow concentrated flow, and then finally it is a stream flow. So here, overland flow is 100 feet. 2.5 average grass cover, 2.5% is the slope, then shallow concentrated flow 600 feet, and 4% slope, and then stream flow is 4700 with 0.3% average cross section as shown in figure. So now, first thing, overland flow. So overland flow, the given data is that 100 feet and 2.5% slope and average grass cover. So let's say, let me try to write in a straight line. Where is 100? So this is basically 100 and I average, sorry, this is, sorry, how to raise it? Okay, so let's just try again. I'm not like, so this thing, and you will take straight it to the pivot point, and then pivot to 2.5 is somewhere here, and you will come here. So this is, you just consider it as a straight line, as it is done for the 200 feet average grass, you came here like in a straight line, and then for the slope, you will intersect the slope and extrapolate it towards the time of concentration. So in this case, we get the 12 minutes. This is somewhere here, 12 minutes for overland flow. Now for shallow concentrated flow, for unpaved surfaces, the velocity is 3.2 feet per second, which we got from this graph. How we got this, I will explain you. So the given data is it's a 600 feet path length and 4% slope. So here it is small, I will go there. So it was 600 feet and 4% slope. So slope is 4%, it is unpaved. So here you will find something, the velocity in feet per second. So it was 3.2 feet per second, the velocity, and you know that time is distance over velocity. So basically 600, which was the distance, and then the velocity is 3.2 feet per second, and you will get the time of concentration for shallow concentrated flow as 3.1 minute. Then there is a stream flow, and we know the area of this, we can find the area of this trapezoidal channel cross section. We know the perimeter, what is the perimeter weight, and where the water touches the cross section of the of any channel, and then R is the hydraulic radius. R is basically the is equal to area divided by wetted perimeter. So we know the Manning formula, as I have explained you in the previous slides, that to find the velocity we will use the Manning's equation, which is V is equal to 1.49 over N, R raised to power 2 by 3 and S raised to power 1 by 2. This S naught is basically the channel slope. So here you can see that the velocity dependent on N, which is basically the Manning roughness coefficient, and R is the hydraulic radius, which is basically the cross-sectional area and the wetted perimeter and the bed slope. So the velocity is dependent on roughness, cross-sectional area, wetted perimeter, and the bed slope of the channel. So from here we have find the time concentration, the velocity, and then the time of concentration is basically the d over t. So the time of concentration for stream flow is 24.1 minute. And then finally we will add all these times, then we will find the time of concentration at 39 minutes. But it is important to remember that not all the Danish basins have the same three types of flow along the flow path. Here, 10.8, we have said that in the whole basin, the initially there is a overland flow, then the shallow concentrated flow, and then the stream flow. But in reality, the conditions are not same for the whole drainage basin. Then we have to divide the basin into sub basins. We will study that later on in this lecture, that how we can divide the catchment area into small sub basins so that the conditions remains constant throughout the smaller portion called subbasin. So this we know, and then now we move towards the rainfall. So we have explained how it rains when the clouds condense, and then it precipitates in the form of rain, snow, and hail. So here is a typical rain gauge. But here I would like to explain that what is basically the intense rain, or in comparison to a non-intense rain. Let's say a rainfall event of 5 inches over 12 hours in one category and a rainfall of 5 inches over 24 hours in another category. Both these events produce the same rainfall. One is more intense, and intensity of rainfall is very important in computing the runoff. So when the rainfall of 5 inches happens in 12 hours, that is more intense storm. Then we need to know the frequency or return period of a rainfall. The probability of occurrence is described by the term return period, which is the average number of years between two rainfall events that equal or exceeds the number of inches over a given duration. For example, a rainfall of 5 inches in 24 hours in Western Texas has a return period of 10 years, and a rainfall of 5 inches in 12 hours has a return period of 25 years, right? So here you can see that 5 inches in 24 hours, it has a return period 10 years, and a 5 inches in 12 hours in a smaller period, 5 inch rainfall, it has a return period of 25 years, because it takes once in a 25 years that 5 inches rainfall happens in 12 hours. Now, if you study this graph here, if I say you what is the return period of the rainfall of 6.5 inches, here is the rainfall of 6.5 inches, this one. So you can see that in 100 years, this is basically years, it happens only once. It only happens once. So the return period, this is a 100-year storm, 6.5. So let's say, if I say 5-inch, if a storm that equals or exceeds 5 inches, what is the return period? So you can see this is the one time and this is the second time, equal or exceeds. So we can say this is basically the 50 years strong. So if a particular rainfall equal or exceeds 3 times, then it is called the, like you can say 33 years strong. So now the next is the rainfall intensity and duration. In this graph, you can see, as let's say this is basically a typical hourly rainfall pattern, and this is basically the intensity pattern derived from the long historical data. If you move towards the center of a rainfall event, right, it will be always intense. And at the start and at the end, its intensity will be lower, right? So let's say if I arbitrarily select a 3-hour intense period, so here in this case, so its intensity is basically 0.9 inches per hour. And if I move to 2 hours intense storm, then intensity is increasing like from 0.9 to 1.25 inches. And if I go move towards 1 hour intense storm, then intensity is like 2 inches per hour. So as you move towards intense period, like a short period, then its intensity will be increased. So we have intensity, duration, frequency curves, which shows the relationship between rainfall intensity and duration. So here there is the rainfall intensity and duration of storms. So from here you can find the return period of storm. So let's say this is a rainfall of 1.33 inches in 20 minutes. So in 1 hour it will be 4 inches per hour. And it is for New Jersey. So I have find the IDF curves for New Jersey. So let's say 4 inches per hour. This is basically the 4 inches per hour. And the duration of storm is basically 20 minutes. So this somewhere straight line this, and this is your 10-year return period storm. So this is how you find the return period for a particular rainfall intensity and duration storm to the intensity duration curves. Now, the next topic is basically the runoff hydrograph. So runoff hydrograph is basically the graph between runoff and time. It is useful to know the entire relationship between runoff and time for a given rainfall event. And when we plot this, this is called a hydrograph. So if you closely inspect this diagram of 10-12, you will find that the slope of the rising portion of the hydrograph is steeper than the falling portion. This is basically the characteristics of all the hydrographs. Why this happens? Because the overland flow is a quick flow. It takes small time for the overland flow to reach from the remotest point to the point of analysis, and then you will see the peak. But then there is a base flow is also moving towards the point of analysis, but it takes larger time in comparison to the surface flow. So that comes slowly. So, but when it reaches, the peak is already gone. So that's why when the base flow combines with the surface runoff or overland flow, then the peak at that time, the peak is already gone. So that's why the groundwater flows more gradually and slowly. So that's why the falling leap is not that steep, that it does not decline the flow steep after the rainfall event or after the peak flow. So although all hydrographs have same general shape, they differ in detail based on the amount of rainfall, rainfall pattern, time of concentration, and the physical characteristics of the drainage basin. So one thing you need to know that the area under the curve is basically the volume. So let's say if I divide this graph into smaller strips. So if I want to take the area of this strip, this is basically area is depth into width. So delta T multiplied by QT. So this is basically the area. So QT has the units of cubic feet per second, and time is also in seconds. So the area is basically the volume. So area under each strip represents the volume of the water. So the area of each strip represents the volume of water flowing past the point of analysis at time t during the time period dt. The area under the entire curve is the summation of the area of all these strips. So the volume of runoff is the same as the volume of excess rainfall. So this is basically how you find the rainfall. And then this curve, which is basically between the runoff, this runoff is direct runoff, that is the water in the streams. Like if there is a rain, if there is a gauge to flow the stream flow, that stream flow is basically the direct runoff. So this runoff hydrograph also includes the base flow, because I have said that the surface runoff or the overland flow will also move towards the river, and then the base flow will also move towards the river. So this hydrograph is basically the combination of direct runoff and the base flow, surface runoff or the base flow. So when I have to separate the direct runoff from the base flow, then there are different methods. There is a software called BFI plus 3.0. You can use that it has different methods how you can separate hydrographs for direct runoff and base flow. But the simple method is you just combine these rising limb starting point to the falling limb, and then the area under this portion is basically the base flow, and that is area above that is called the direct runoff. So then I have explained that the direct runoff is basically the combination of overland flow and the subsurface flow. So, and these both the flows originates due to rainfall. But when the rainfall happens, not all the rainfall becomes runoff. Some of the rainfall is lost during this runoff processes to infiltration and evaporation. It could be either ponding and even evapotranspiration. So the rainfall that becomes the part of runoff is called the rainfall excess. So here in this diagram, you can see this is a 24 hours time. In the initial 8 hours, whatever the rainfall was, it was the losses. And then when these losses were fulfilled, then the runoff started, and then this runoff was also divided into base flow and also the surface flow. So this is the representation, that this is the infiltration. So it will move towards the river as a base flow, and then this will move towards the jet flow. And all of this thing is based on the excess rainfall. The rainfall that becomes the part of runoff is called the rainfall excess. There are different runoff hydrograph methods, like direct measurement hydrograph, synthetic hydrograph. So we will study them later in this course. The direct measurement runoff hydrograph, I will explain, you just remember that, is used for large river basins where one or more measuring stations are used to record the actual hydrographs, right? And synthetic hydrographs are used for small drainage basin where there is a no measured runoff data is available. In these cases, the method must be devised to reasonably predict the hydrograph resulting from a given rainfall, even without having measured actual runoff at the site. So unit hydrograph, what is unit hydrograph? So if, let's say, now we know what hydrograph is. Hydrograph is basically a relationship when you plot the runoff versus time, that is called the hydrograph. So what exactly is a unit hydrograph, right? Both synthetic hydrographs and direct measurement hydrographs are constructed by using the principle of unit hydrograph. So unit hydrograph, if you have to define it, is resulting from a one unit of rainfall excess falling over the drainage basin in one unit of time. The one unit of rainfall excess is 1 inch in English system of units and 1 millimeter in SI system of units. So basically, the unit of time is variable, but it's really taken as a fraction of the time of concentration, typically 1/5. Let me just open one thing. Right, so let's say we study this diagram. Here there is a rainfall which is plotted on secondary axis, and this is basically the excess rainfall of 1 inch, right? Then we have the runoff. So for this excess rainfall of 1 inch, there will be, let's say there is a rainfall, and then the result of that rainfall will be a runoff hydrograph, not a runoff hydrograph, rainfall and runoff. So when we plotted that runoff, let's say at any point of analysis, then this was the curve of that runoff. So from the center of excess rainfall to the peak is called the lag time, which is basically, normally it is 0.6 into the time of concentration. And time of concentration is basically when the rainfall ends, the excess rainfall ends. From that moment, the water from the remotest point to reach the point of analysis called the time of concentration, and it is normally after it reaches after the peak is gone. So that's why the time of concentration starts from this point at the end of the excess rainfall, and it leads towards the somewhere after the peak at the point of, and that point is called basically the point of inflection. So this is the unit hydrograph. So what basically the purpose of unit hydrograph? Let's say you have draw the for a particular catchment, for each catchment there will be a different unit hydrograph for a unit rainfall, right? Let's say in my area, I'm living currently in Sawabi, in the Industry River section of a catchment. Let's say if I know the rainfall for a particular rainfall, let's say unit rainfall, I know the unit hydrograph, the runoff basically, which will reach to the river. So let's say if there will be 1.5 times the rainfall of that, then I will simply multiply this hydrograph with a factor of 1.5, and then the new hydrograph I will obtain, so that I don't have to go to the gauge and measure the peaks. So this is basically the purpose. So you can or you can superposition different hydrographs to superposition different unit hydrographs to find your runoff hydrograph. So there are some assumptions. Don't be confused. I will explain you what is the principles and how you multiply this and how you merge this. So I will explain you this slide, just a moment. So there are some assumptions. First, for the unit hydrograph, the first thing is rainfall is constant throughout the unit time. This is the main assumption, that throughout the unit time, the rainfall is constant. Then the next assumption is the rainfall is uniformly distributed over the drainage basin. So it's not that in the entire basin, the somewhere of this particular unit, rainfall distribution is different, in the other part is different. So it is distributed uniformly over the whole drainage basin. And the third one is the principle of proportionality. And the fourth one is basically the assumption is the principle of superposition. What are these principles of proportionality and what is the principle of superposition? I will explain you in the next slides. Let's say in the previously I have explained you that for our 1 inch rainfall, which is basically our unit rainfall, in a unit time, we have derived our hydrograph, unit hydrograph. Now, in this case, the rainfall is not now the one inch, it is 1.5 inch. So what we did, we multiply our unit hydrograph with a factor of 1.5, and then you got the derived hydrograph. You will see that the peaks will be aligned. So this is basically the principle of proportionality. And now if you talk about the principle of superposition, here is the scenario that there is a 1 inch rainfall. Then there is, in the next hour, there is no rainfall. And then again, there is a 1 inch rainfall. So for initial rainfall, you have your hydrograph, and then the other rainfall of 1 inch, you again have a same hydrograph, but the difference is basically the unit time between these two excess rainfall. So what we need to do, you at this point where this hydrograph starts, so you just have to add these both hydrographs and you will find the new derived hydrograph. So this is how the principle of superposition works. Now we have a problem. A unit hydrograph for a certain watershed is given in a tabular form in table 10-1. The basin is 2.5 hours, lag time is 2.5 hours. Sketch the, so what was the basin lag? So lag was basically the center of the excess rainfall to the peak. So sketch the derived hydrograph resulting from the rainfall distribution depicted below. So this is the given data, that the discharge you know against the time, and you know the rainfall. So here, rainfall pattern. So first, for now, there is a typo mistake. This is not rainfall. This is basically the time. So this is basically the time. So first hour, there was rainfall, but it was a rainfall. It was a rain loss. In the second hour, the rainfall was 1 inch, but the complete 1 inch rainfall was a loss. In the 2 to 3, in the third hour, the rainfall was 2 inch, but 1 inch was the rainfall losses and the other 1 inch was the rainfall excess. In the 3 to 4 hour period, the total rainfall was 1.5 inch and 1 inch was the rainfall excess and the 0.5 inch was the rainfall loss. And then the next time period, there was 1 inch rainfall, half was loss and half was how was excess rainfall, and the final interval there was rainfall of 0.5 inch and it was again the rainfall loss. So if you study this, you will see then there is a one inch rainfall excess, then again there is a 1 inch rainfall excess, and then there is a 0.5 inch rainfall excess. And this is basically the discharge which is given to you, which was observed at the point of, this is basically the unit hydrograph discharges, right, which you have prepared. And now you have, from this unit hydrograph against this rainfall distribution, you have to find the runoff hydrograph, not the unit hydrograph. Unit hydrograph is for the unit rainfall, right? This is for the unit rainfall, which is basically 1 inch. So here in this first portion, the rainfall is 1 inch. Here it is again 1 inch and there is 0.5. So for 1 inch, the rainfall will remain same. So let's say we move towards the solution. So runoff hydrograph, as it is equal to unit hydrograph, so it is same. Then there is a difference of 1 hour. So these values will move to the 1 hour later. So for these two, both runoff hydrograph, as these were same as unit hydrograph, and then the unit hydrograph number 3, which was basically for this rain, which is 0.5. So we have the values. So for 20, and it will move again 1 hour later. So 14, 28 have 14, 100 have 50, 78 have 39. And then you sum all these hydrographs, you will get the your runoff hydrograph. So if you plot this time versus this sum of these three, then you will get this dried runoff hydrograph. So this is how you basically draw your hydrographs. I hope you haven't understood. If you have any question, you can write in the comments or you send an email. So now about the sub-basins. When we were studying this slide and the shape, I think the figure. Here I have told you that then the whole basin, the initially there was a wellland flow, then shallow concentrated flow, and the finally, there was stream flow. But I have told you that in reality, it is difficult, that it's not nearly impossible that for entire basin, there will be initially a overland flow. Because the characteristics of whole basin is not really the same. So what we do that to analysis to make things similar in the entire catchment, we divide the basin into smaller sub-basins where the characteristics are more or less same. So here in this, let's say this was the basin, complete basin. There are two rivers, one is this and one is this. Where they merge is called the point of analysis or the point of confluence. So at this point, we delineate the catchment and then we divide it into two sub-basins. One is number one and the other is number two. So now the characteristics of sub-basin one is same and the characteristics of sub-basin two is the same. So next, there is a problem. Find the runoff hydrograph for the drainage basin depicted in Figure 10-21. For 25 years storm, the runoff hydrographs for the two subbasins are shown in tabular form in column 2 and 3 in table 3. So column 2 and 3 in table 3. So these are the runoff hydrographs for. So what you need to do is you just have to simply add those. All those hydrographs for subbasin 1 and 2, and then you add them, and if you total them, then this will be your final hydrograph. So this is how you divide the catchment into subbasins, and you take their hydrographs and you combine them, and at the point of analysis you get your complete runoff hydrograph to study the hydrology and flow characteristics. So this was the first lecture of Fundamental of Hydrology. I will try my best to make all the video lectures of the course